Hello, good morning. Sandeep Mukherjee here. I welcome you back to the discussion on Article 311. Last time what we discussed was the two rights available under Article 311. I'm sure you would recall that the first was that he shall not be dismissed or removed by an authority subordinate to that by which he was appointed. And the second one was, even if the competent authority wants to dismiss or remove or reduce in rank a government servant, he will have to hold an inquiry in which he will have to inform the charges and a reasonable opportunity has to be given to the government servant before he can be dismissed or removed. Now, the question with which we ended the last discussion was, who is covered by the clause 1? Who is holder of a civil post? Who is holder of a, who is a member of a civil service of the union? Now, whether employees of the banks or employees of the public sector undertakings or employees of the autonomous bodies, are they covered by clause 1? The answer is no. The court, Supreme Court have held, and this is now a settled issue, that they are not holders of civil post and therefore they will not be covered by the Article 311. So this protection of Article 311 is applicable or available only to those who are working in the government. That means those who are working with the ministries and departments. The PSUs or the autonomous bodies, of course, will fall under the definition of state under Article 12. But they are not holders of the civil post. So we will not go too much into this discussion. But I'm sure you understand that they will not have the protection of 311, those who are working in the banks, PSUs, autonomous bodies. That does not mean that they do not have this protection in their service. Their rules provide these protections. And therefore, they have this protection through their own rules and regulations, not through the constitution. Let me also explain this point in this way, that if a government department makes a rule and says that a person can be dismissed or removed, let us say one rank below the person who appointed him, it will be immediately held as violative of Clause 1 of Article 311. But let us say, just for the sake of argument, that a public sector undertaking makes a rule that a person can be dismissed or removed by an authority even one rank below the person who appointed him. That person cannot go to the court and say that he has the protection of 311, therefore this rule which the PSU has framed is violative of 311 for the simple reason that employees of the PSUs or the banks or autonomous bodies do not have its protection. Now, I would like to end this discussion on who is covered by clause 1 here and move forward. Now, 311 has clause 1 and clause 2, and thereafter comes the first proviso. Now, you surely know proviso is kind of an exception to whatever has been said before in the law. So, the first proviso says, which was brought through an amendment of, which was slightly changed by in 1977 by 42nd constitutional amendment. It says that provided that where it is proposed after such inquiry to impose upon him any such penalty may be imposed on the basis of evidence adduced during such inquiry, and it shall not be necessary to give such person any opportunity of making representation on the penalty proposed. Now, let us break down this entire paragraph into two parts. One, in these four lines, the Constitution reminds everybody that you will have to hold an inquiry. And after holding inquiry, if you want to impose a penalty on him, on the government servant, then please remember that you will have to impose that penalty based on an evidence which has come during the inquiry. That means if any evidence is received after the inquiry is over or outside the inquiry, that means it is not brought during the inquiry, but still available with the discipline authority, and he then decides to impose the penalty based on that evidence which was not brought during the inquiry, it will not be correct and violative of the first proviso to the Article 311. The second part says, and this is what the main portion which was amended in 1977. Before 1977, the position at it was that a government servant, after inquiry was over, the discipline authority would again give him an opportunity of the specific penalty that he wanted to impose on. Now this has been done away with. Now the discipline authority will not give another representation to government servant that, look, I intend to impose this penalty, let us say dismissal or removal or compulsory retirement. He will not give this opportunity. And this has been done away with from the 42nd Constitutional Amendment, 1977. Now, after this proviso, there comes the second proviso. Now, I'll show you the entire proviso that says that, provided further, that this clause shall not apply. Now, before you read this part, I'll just ask you a question. What do we mean by provided further that this clause shall not apply? Which clause? Right, you are. The clause 2. It uses the word this clause. It does not use the word clauses, these clauses. So it said this clause. And what is the last clause? Clause 2. So the Constitution is now saying that the clause 2 shall not be applicable in few specific situations, which it tells very clearly in the second proviso, and which we will discuss shortly. But what it is now saying is that a government servant can be dismissed or removed or reduced in rank without holding any inquiry. That means this clause, which mandates inquiry, has been done away with if certain specific situations arises. And what are those situations? Let us see all three. There are three situations, not four, not five, not two, only three. And those three situations are, I will request you to go one by one. There are three situations, A, B, and C. Now, A says where a person is dismissed or removed or reduced in rank on the ground of conduct, which has led to his conviction in a criminal charge. In other words, suppose if a government servant has been convicted in a criminal charge, in that case, if the department or if the competent authority wants to dismiss or remove him, they can do it without holding inquiry. Because the purpose of inquiry is to give him a reasonable opportunity to defend himself that he has already got in the criminal case, and that is thereafter only there the conviction stands. So he got all the reasonable opportunity when the criminal case took place against him. Now, the point to be noted here is that it does not say that in all conviction in criminal charge, he will be dismissed only. He will have to be dismissed. What it is saying that in case you want to dismiss or remove him, there will not be any need to hold inquiry against the government servant. So this is a proviso. Proviso, you remember what is proviso, is an exception. So this is an exception to the clause 2 that inquiry is mandatory. Now, interesting part is that it says conviction on a criminal charge. Conviction could be simply fine. It could be fine plus sentence, imprisonment. It could be only imprisonment. It could be anything. So even if a person is, you know, convicted by imposing a fine, even in that case, this can be invoked. Proviso A can be invoked by the department. Now, let us come to the C. We'll discuss B little later. Let us discuss C first. B requires a little more lengthy discussion. Let us quickly dispose of C. What is C? It says, where the president or the governor, as the case may be, is satisfied that in the interest of the security of the state, it is not expedient to hold such inquiry. In other words, if the And the president or the governor is of the opinion that in the interest of the security of the state, it is not wise to hold the inquiry. Because the moment you hold inquiry, what you will have to do? You will have to give him an opportunity. You will have to inform him of the charges. In fact, what interest of the security of the state could be so secret a matter that in case you inform him of the charges, it will be known. So interest of the security of the state is paramount, and in that the person can be dismissed or removed without holding inquiry. And but who will take this decision? Who will dismiss or remove the person? Now, it is not the person who appointed the government servant. The constitution says it is the president in the case of central government and governor in the case of state government. So it is the highest authority, executive authority, which is now taking a call that interest of the security of the state is involved and we will not hold an inquiry. So it is possible that you are removing even a lower division clerk or even a chaprasi from the government of India whose appointing authority will be deputy secretary or director level officer. Yet, when he will be removed or dismissed, the decision will be taken at the highest level, president. And if you recall, whenever we said we will use the word president here, it basically means the minister concerned. So it is the minister of that ministry that who will take this call that interest of the security of the state is in. So there are two provisos you have seen that where without holding an inquiry, a government servant can be removed or dismissed from service. Now we'll wind up today's discussion. I would request you to meet next time with me. And till that time, you can do a little bit of reading on the proviso B. And we'll discuss in detail what is this B, which says where the authority empowered to dismiss or remove a person or to reduce him in rank is satisfied that for some reason to be recorded by that authority in writing, it is not reasonably practicable to hold such inquiry. Mark each word is important. It is, first of all, insisting that he has to record it in writing. In clause C, there was no such condition, but it has to be in writing. And it is using very interesting juxtaposition of words. It's saying not reasonably practicable. Kindly note, it is not using the word not practicable. It is using the words not reasonably practicable. So if the authority feels that it is not reasonably practicable to hold inquiry, it may do away with the inquiry and dismiss or remove a government servant from the service. Now, what could be the situation when it is not reasonably practicable to hold inquiry is very interesting. In fact, a general reading of this, it is appearing very draconian that anybody can write that it is not reasonably practicable to hold inquiry and dismiss a government servant from the service. The question arose in 1986, this whole issue of where B is applicable went before the Supreme Court in 1986, and it delivered a landmark judgment, Tulsi Ram Patel case. So we will meet next time and discuss in detail when this is applicable, but I would request all the listeners to just Google search for Tulsi Ram Patel case and read what they can read so that when we discuss this next time, you will be better able to appreciate the discussion. So thank you very much. We'll meet again next time. Bye-bye.